There are a couple of things that we can do to extend our VPCs and make our routing and security group management a bit easier. So the first is to add secondary CIDR blocks. That's where you can add additional CIDR blocks to your VPC. Now, when you create your VPC, you create the primary CIDR block, and any additional ones you create are known as secondary CIDR blocks. And there's a few rules that you have to adhere to when you create them. Prefix lists are another important topic for the exam and a great way to make your routing and your security group management a little bit easier. So we're going to look at these in quite a bit of detail in this lesson. So firstly, let's cover secondary CIDR blocks. So you cannot increase or decrease the size of any existing CIDR blocks. So let's say that you run out of IP addresses or you need to support some new application or a whole load of new VPCs. And they require some addresses which either are different to the ones you already have, or they require more addresses than are available in your current VPC architecture. So you can add then secondary CIDR blocks to your VPC. A local route is added to the VPC route tables for each CIDR block that you add. These secondary CIDR blocks must adhere to the VPC rules for allowed ranges, just as the primary CIDR block does. And you really need to make sure that this secondary CIDR block does not overlap with your existing CIDR blocks. There are some specific permitted and restricted CIDR block associations, and it always depends on the primary VPC CIDR block that you chose. Now, one of them that I'll point out for the exam, you need to know all of them, but for the exam, make sure you remember that you cannot associate RFC 1918 ranges if the primary CIDR block is non-RFC 1918. So remember, RFC 1918 is a RFC that specifies some ranges of addresses that you can use privately, and they're never routable on the internet. So let's have a look at some examples of the permitted and restricted associations. In this VPC, the primary CIDR is a non-RFC 1918 address. So I've color-coded these addresses. This is not a private range. This is a publicly routable IP address. So we have some subnets within that CIDR block range. Now for the secondary CIDR block, we've also added a non-RFC 1918 address. So is that okay? Well, yes, that is a permitted association. What if we then wanted to add another CIDR block, and this one is using an RFC 1918 address, so the address space is a private IP address space? Well, you can't do that. That's a restricted association. So if the primary CIDR is from a non-RFC 1918 range, you cannot add secondary CIDRs from RFC 1918 ranges. So really important to remember. Now, this is what the route table will look like in this example. Remember that a local route gets added for each CIDR block that you add to your VPC. Let's look at another example. In this case, the primary CIDR block is a private IP address range within the RFC 1918 address space. So in this case, we add a secondary CIDR block, and that's using a non-RFC 1918 address. Is that allowed? Well, yes, it is. So you can associate a secondary CIDR block from a non-private address space if your primary CIDR block is from a private address space. And what if we then try to add a third CIDR block to our VPC using a private address space? Well, that's allowed as well. So that's also a permitted association. So if the primary CIDR block is from a RFC 1918 range, you can add secondary CIDRs from the same RFC 1918 range and non-RFC 1918 ranges. Now, note that I do specify there that it's from the same private address space. Okay, so it's from the same range of addresses. So you see that this is 10 and this is 10 as well. So it's a different CIDR block, but it's within that same range of addresses, and that's okay. Now, in this case, the route table, again, will have some routes for each of those CIDR blocks that are marked as local. So those were a few practical examples. Let's now have a look at the detailed rules. So if your primary CIDR block is in the 10 range, then you cannot have CIDR blocks from other RFC 1918 ranges. So that's the restricted association I mentioned before. If your primary CIDR block is from the 10/15 range, you cannot add a CIDR block from the 10/16 range. And CIDR blocks from the 198.19.0.0/16 range are also restricted. Now, what you can do if you have this primary CIDR block is you can add any other CIDR block from the 10/8 range that's not restricted. Any publicly routable IPv4 CIDR block, so non-RFC1918, or a CIDR block from the 100.64/10 range. Next, if we have a primary CIDR block, and remember this is another RFC1918 range, so this is another private address space, you can't then have CIDR blocks from other RFC1918 ranges like the 10/8 or the 192.168/16. You can't have CIDR blocks from the 172.31/16 range or from the 198.19/16 range. What you can do is have any other CIDR block from the 172.16/12 range that's not restricted, and any publicly routable CIDR block or a CIDR block from this 100.64/10 range. So there's a few more. The next one is also a private address space. So we've got the 192.168/16. Again, the restricted associations are CIDR blocks from other RFC1918 ranges and CIDR blocks from the 198.19/16 range. Now, the key thing is you don't need to remember every single detail here. You probably won't see exam questions coming up asking you about this specific 198 range. But what they will test you on is that you understand that if the primary CIDR block is RFC1918, that you can't have an association that's from another RFC1918 range. Similarly, if that primary CIDR block is not a private address space, then you can't have private address spaces as secondary CIDR blocks. So let's continue. What are the permitted associations for this particular CIDR block? Well, any other CIDR block from the 192.168.16 range and any publicly routable CIDR block or a CIDR from this 164.10 range. The next CIDR block is from a public address space. So this is not a private address space. This is non-RFC1918. In this case, you can have CIDR blocks from the RFC1918 ranges without any other restrictions. And you can also have any publicly routable IPv4 CIDR block or that 164.10 range. And then lastly, if you have a publicly routable CIDR block or a CIDR block from the 164/10 range, then the restricted associations are CIDR blocks from the RFC1918 ranges, you can't have those, and CIDR blocks from the 198.19/16 range. What you can do then is have any other publicly routable IPv4 CIDR block or the CIDR block which is 164/10. So quite a bit of detail there, but just try and remember the basic patterns here and you'll be okay for the exam. Next, we have something called prefix lists. Now, these are a set of one or more CIDR blocks. And what they're used for is simplifying the configuration and maintenance of things like route tables and security groups. You can reference the prefix lists in your security group rules and in routes within your route tables. Now, there are two different types of prefix list. There are the customer managed prefix lists. So these are sets of IP ranges that you define and that you manage. Then there's the AWS managed prefix lists, and these are for specific AWS services, and you can't modify these in any way. So let's have a look at a couple of examples of prefix lists so you understand what they are. So here are some of the AWS managed prefix lists that you'll be able to see in your account. So here we have a prefix list for DynamoDB, S3, and CloudFront. So what this means is this prefix list is actually going to have some entries in it, and those are the actual IP addresses for S3. Now, of course, those can change from time to time, but you might want to be able to reference Amazon S3 in a security group rule to allow certain services to speak to S3, and you don't want to have to hard code the IP addresses in because obviously they could change. So instead, what they've done is created a prefix list. You can add that to your route table, and now whenever the entries change, you don't have to do anything. Now, similarly, you can do the same sort of thing if you have sets of IP address ranges that you can consolidate or aggregate into a prefix list, and then you can reference them in a security group rule or put them into a route table, and it makes life a bit easier.